So we were in the hadith of Abi Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This hadith is a very powerful hadith, has many benefits in it. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said, يَنْبَغِي أَنْ يُعْرَفَ أَنَّ هَذَا الْحَدِيثَ شَرِيفُ الْقَدْرِ عَظِيمُ الْمَنْزِلَةِ وَلِهَذَا كَانَ الْإِمَامُ أَحْمَدُ بْنُ حَنْبَلٍ يَقُولُ هُوَ أَشْرَفُ حَدِيثٍ لِأَهْلِ الشَّامِ وَكَانَ أَبُو إِدْرِيسَ الْخَوْلَانِي إِذَا حَدَّثَ بِهِ جَثَى عَلَى رُكْبَتِهِ. This hadith, he says, it should be known how great it is, how noble this hadith is. وَلِذَلِكَ الْإِمَامُ أَحْمَدُ used to say, this hadith is the best hadith that the people of Sham narrated. Ahlu Sham, this is their best hadith. Abu Idris al-Khawlani, which is from the great imams of Ahlu Sham, he was from the great imams of Ahlu Sham. Whenever he would narrate this hadith, جثى على ركبته, he will fall on his knees. The hadith of Abi Dharr al-Ghifari, Ya Ibadi. Whenever he would narrate it, he would go on his knees because of the powerful meaning that he saw in this hadith. Naam.
عن أبي ذر رضي الله عنه أيضا أن ناسا من أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قالوا للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رسول الله ذاب أهل الدثور بالأجور يصلون كما نصلي ويصومون كما نصوم ويتصدقون بفضول أموالهم قال أوليس قد جعل الله لكم ما تصدقون إن بكل تسبيحة صدقة وكل تكبيرة صدقة وكل تحميدة صدقة وكل تهليلة صدقة وأمر بالمعروف صدقة ونهي عن المنكر صدقة وفي بضع أحدكم صدقة قالوا يا رسول الله أيأتي أحدنا شهوته ويكون له فيها أجر قال أرأيتم لو وضعها في الحرام أكان عليه فيها وزر فكذلك إذا وضعها في الحلال كان له أجر رواه مسلم.
This hadith again is a very powerful hadith that talks about virtuous actions. A group of people, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then they said, O Messenger of Allah, ذهب أهل الدثور. أهل الدثور are أهل الأموال, the rich people. They have taken, ذهب أهل الدثور بالأجور. They took all the reward. The rich people have taken all of the reward. How? يصلون كما نصلي. They pray with us. وَيَصُومُونَ كَمَا نَصُومُ And they fast the way that we fast. وَيَتَصَدَّقُونَ بِفُضُولِ أَمْوَالِهِمْ But they have something extra, which is that they give their wealth out. They pray with us, they fast with us, they do all the goods with us, but then they have something separate for them, which is then they go, they give their wealth out. Not us. وَيَتَصَدَّقُونَ بِفُضُولِ أَمْوَالِهِمْ Their wealth that they have, they go and they give it out. Then the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, أَوَلَيْسَ قَدْ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ مَا تَصَدَّقُونَ بِهِ Allah has given you guys something that you can give. If they give sadaqah, you guys can give sadaqah as well. The Prophet told them, إِنَّ بِكُلِّ تَسْبِيحَةٍ صَدَقَةٍ وَبِكُلِّ تَكْبِيرَةٍ صَدَقَةٍ وَبِكُلِّ تَحْمِيدَةٍ صَدَقَةٍ وَبِكُلِّ تَهْلِيلَةٍ All of these are sadaqah. Say them. وَأَمْرُ بِمَعْرُوفٍ صَدَقَةٍ Calling to the good and prohibiting the evil is a sadaqah. وَنَهْيٌ عَنْ مُنْكَرٍ Sadaqah. وَفِي بُضْعِ أَحَدِكُمْ Sadaqah. The intimate relationship that a man has with his wife is also a sadaqah. He gets rewarded for it. قَالُوا يَا The Sahabas and they said, Ya Rasulullah, أَيَأْتِي أَحَدُنَا شَهْوَتَهُ Is one of us going to fulfill his desires and have intimate relationship with his spouse? And then he gets rewarded for that. Because the other ones, the nafs is a bit hard to give out your money. To call to the good and prohibit the evil, sometimes it's hard because the people may not like you. Sitting down and doing tasbih and tahmeed, the nafs doesn't like it. So they can see where the ajr is coming from. But fulfilling your desires with your spouse is something that the nafs wants. And so the sahabas thought that the reward is only connected to what the nafs doesn't like. So So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, وَفِي بُطْعِ حَدِكُمْ صَدَقَةً. And then the Prophet said, the Sahaba, they said, is one of us going to fulfill his desires and he gets rewarded for it? The Prophet said, نعم. He said, of course. أَرَأَيْتُمْ لَوْ وَضَعَهَا فِي حَرَامٍ. If he was to go and fulfill his desires in a haram way, would he take a sin for it? Yes. Then of course, if he does it in a halal way, he gets rewarded for it. It makes sense that the opposite is true. This is where the Usuliyin took a qa'ida, which is, it's called Qiyasul Aksi. Qiyasul Aksi means the analogy of the opposite. Something is haram on this side, so the opposite should be that it's halal on the other side. Sah? It's called Qiyasul Aksi. Qiyasu al-Aksi. The Prophet said that. فَكَذَلِكَ إِذَا وَضَعَ فِي الْحَلَالِ كَانَ لَهُ أَجْرٌ. Of course, he only gets rewarded if he comes with the intention. You get the reward if you come with the intention. Some of the narrations mention the rich people they had. They were informed about what the poor people asked about. They were informed that the poor people asked about a way to catch up with the rich people. And so the rich people started to do what? They started to do all of this. Tasbih and tahmid and tahleel. So the poor people came and they said, Ya Rasulullah, look, this is not fair. They do everything that we are doing and they're also passing us in the wealth that they can give. And then the Prophet said, ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِيهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. That's a blessing from Allah, He gives it to whoever He wills. What can one do? It's their blessing. They've got wealth to give. So Islam, brothers, it doesn't condemn wealth in its essence. It only condemns it in the way that it's utilized. If some or a person who has wealth and he uses that wealth in the religion and he builds masajids and he gives sadaqah and he takes care of orphans and he buys Islamic libraries for people to benefit from, he gets the reward of all of those people. Lahu ajr. His wealth, what? Is truly good and praiseworthy. And little can reach that person, right? Because of what he's doing. What he's doing. So brothers, your wealth can sometimes make you reach levels. Only Allah knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'am. Huh? Tahmeed is say alhamdulillah. And tahleel is say la ilaha illallah. Sahih. The intention is very important. I'll give you an example of what the brother mentioned. That there's a person who doesn't have much. He's poor. He only has one bread. And he gives that bread for someone. He just says, take it, eat it. He sees someone who wants it. And he says, take this bread. And a rich person gave 10 million. But he's got another 10 million in his account. The ajr la shakka wa la raib is more greater in, with the poor person who just gave out the one thing he had. Are we all together? So it's not the quantity necessarily, it's the intention that you give it with. Some of the scholars, they said Abu Bakr and Umar, when they both gave out, who gave out more? Umar gave out more than Abu Bakr. Like, and who was greater? Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr was greater. لأن Abu Bakr gave everything he had. But that was little. In comparison to the half of Umar. رضي الله تعالى عنه. Are we all together? So it's how you give it. It's how you give it. And with the intention that you give it. It's very great. Just today, me and my father were talking about some of the rich people of my community. And some of them, how they spend their wealth in good. How, what they've done with it. And where their wealth reached, subhanAllah, that millions of people are benefiting from the things that they've done, the value that it holds. So sometimes try to look at that in a positive way, that your wealth and your finance and your money, it's something that's going to go, ya ikhwa. Or you're going to die out of it and leave it, and you're no longer going to have this wealth. Are we all together? It may not remain forever. Give it. Tasaddaq biha. The person who's going to benefit from your sadaqah is yourself. You are going to benefit from it. First of all, no one else. And then those who are around you, the things that they do with that wealth that you gave them, and the khayr that they do with it, the reward will come to you the day of judgment, when you're unexpecting it. That there was a person, you one day brought him a book, and he said, read this. And then he read that book and it changed his life, for example. And he memorized that book and the ilm in that book, that Islamic book you gave him. That's a reward for you. So remember to not belittle the wealth that we have. Alhamdulillah, Allah has given us to give it out. Bukhl is not a good thing. A person who is bakhil is a very bad trait. Someone who, whenever he gives money out, he sweats. And he becomes very nervous. And his hands start shaking. And he starts breathing heavily when he has to give something out. But the Prophet, when he came to Medina, the city of Medina, Nabiullah Muhammad, when he came, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came to a place where, of course, there were other tribes and other belief systems and other religions. So there were Jews that were living there. They had their own leader. They had their own leader for their tribes. And the tribes that were there, they had their leaders. Sahih? The Prophet never took no one from their position and said, you know what, I've now come to Medina, step down. He didn't. He let every tribe and every community have their leader. There was only one man they said that he told him to step down. And the only reason why he did is because he was trying to run his people based on bukhl. He was a very stingy man. Are we all together? If you read the seerah, Abdul Muttalib, you all know Abdul Muttalib, right? Who's Abdul Muttalib? Yeah? The Prophet's granddad, right? They said that Quraysh respected him and they admired him. This is before Islam. How was he able to run Quraysh? And how would they come and they would listen to him? Abdul Muttalib. He gave. Abdul Muttalib gave to his people. He took care of their hunger and their need. And the people were muta'een and they obeyed him. They listened to him. Whatever he got, he gave. Whatever he got, he gave. Whatever he got, he gave. A bakhil person cannot run two people. Stingy person cannot run two people. He cannot do anything. Are we all together? Because people have needs. Are we all together? They have needs. And those needs need to be fulfilled for them. So you should be a person, this money, it came and it will go. Ya ikhwa, it's going to go. It's going to go one day. Spend it in khair. Get reward from it. How many people had money and invested in places, or they built buildings and they made this and they made that, and days later they were broke. They had nothing. Without no wealth, sah? Are we all together, brothers? I saw with my eyes, wallahi, a man who was, he used to give sadaqah a lot. Now I'll even tell you a story, subhanAllah. There was a man, what he did was, he thought wisely about how he wants to take his family out of poverty, his family. He thought about it. He said, I need to take my family out of poverty. This is my country. He said, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to speak to the wealthy people of my community, including myself. The zakat that is obligatory on each and every one of us, he told everyone to bring it to him. He asked the family to list themselves, relatives, all of them write themselves down, the fuqara, the poor ones, and that don't have wealth. 5 years, he took his whole entire family out of poverty. Just by the zakat they collected from the people, he used that to take his whole family out of poverty. 5 years later, the poor people were given the zakat. They were in the list of the ones who were given the zakat. And they were looking for people outside to give it to. Until the whole entire area and region, he was able to take care of their financial needs. The zakat that everyone has to pay. He said, give it. No problem, pay. Let's take care of our family, our little relatives. You see? تُؤْخَذُ مِنْ أَغْنِيَائِهِمْ فَتُرَدُّ إِلَى فُقَرَائِهِمْ. And everybody likes to give their zakat because they know it's obligatory, right? The poverty was gone, they were taken care of. Are we all together? So, I even saw that same man that I'm talking about right now, he had a property, a land. The other entire lands that were around his land burnt, and his one didn't. This is Allah protects you for you, your wealth. Allah will protect it for you. And make sure that whatever you have, it increases. The Prophet told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the sadaqah that you give and the wealth that you give, brothers, it does not reduce from your wealth. Are we all together? One day I remember I gave a money to a brother and I had nothing after that. I remember I gave it to him. Wallahi, I'm not lying. Allah is my witness. The same amount of money I gave came into my account. Till today, I don't know who put it in there. And I don't believe in these hocus pocus stories. But this is haq, wallahi, I saw it in my eyes. I saw this. I gave the wealth out. It was not even 1%, no money was put. I gave to this person, and someone put that same money, the same, ya ikhwah. It was not one penny more, not one penny less. Then I said to myself, I wish I gave more. Yeah. Sadaqah does not reduce from your wealth. Some people might say, but it has reduced from my wealth. You know what it does for you, sadaqah? When you give it, lillah. What it does, brothers, is that it brings comfort in your heart. The fear of poverty leaves you. People who give sadaqah don't fear poverty. Why are they not able to fear poverty? Because Allah filled their heart with richness. Even if their money is reducing, they feel no worry about the wealth. Are we all together? So giving is going to benefit you a lot. Mentally, it's going to benefit you. Emotionally, it's going to benefit you. And inshallah ta'ala, your wealth is going to increase with the blessings of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Naam.
Al-Hadith 26. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كل سلامة من الناس عليه صدقة كل يوم تطلع فيه الشمس تعدل بين اثنين صدقة وتعين الرجل في دايته في دابته فتحمله عليها أو ترفع له عليها متاعه صدقة والكلمة الطيبة صدقة وبكل خطوة تمشيها إلى الصلاة صدقة وتميط الأذى عن الطريق صدقة رواه البخاري ومسلم.
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he told us, كل سلامة من الناس. The word سلامة is المفصل, is the joints. So the joints that are in the human being is 360 joints, right? 360. Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih min Haditha Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that the joints of the human is how many? 360. Are we all together? I came across some people who said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, look how knowledgeable he is in science. He knew that the human body has 360 joints. Allahu Akbar. This shows that the religion of Islam is true. You sticking to these kind of things is not in your advantage. Why? Because the Arabs knew that before Nabi Muhammad came. It was ilm, which was what? Was well known. It was a well known knowledge amongst them that the joints are 360. Does that make sense? The Prophet affirmed that knowledge. Lakin it's not something that a person should use, and if you do use that stuff for an argument to show Islam is true or not, it can easily be responded to. So it's best not to use those kind of arguments. We say that the Prophet ﷺ, other things are more enough to show his prophecy. There are other things to show that he's a prophet min indillahi azza wa jalla, and that he should be followed. Sahih. Not necessarily the scientific things that are mentioned here or there. كُلُّ سُلَامَ مِنَ النَّاسِ عَلَيْهِ صَدَقَةٍ. Every individual, there's sadaqah from on your joints. 360. It's wajib on you. Every single day. تَعْدِلُ بَيْنِ اثْنَيْنِ صَدَقَةٍ. If you are just between two people, it's a sadaqah. وَتُعِينُ الرَّجُلَ فِي دَابَتِي فَتَحْمِلُهُ عَلَيْهَا. You see a man who's carrying some load and you take the load for him. That's sadaqah. وَالْكَلِمَةُ الطَّيِّبَةُ صَدَقَةُ Saying good words to someone is sadaqah. To be very nice in your wordings and to speak nicely to people and be respectful in the way you talk, sadaqah. وَبِكُلِّ خُطْوَةٍ تَمْشِيهَا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ صَدَقَةً And every step that you take to the masjid is a sadaqah. وَتُمِيطُ الْأَذَى عَنِ الطَّرِيقِ صَدَقَةً And every harm that you take away from the road, it's a what? It's a sadaqah. Those are all sadaqah that a person makes. And then the sadaqah is not as restricted as we thought. That it's only money. All of that is sadaqah. Naam. Yeah. Some scholars, they take from this hadith that كُلُّ سُلَامَ عَلَيْهِ صَدَقَةً means تَجِبُ عَلَى الْعَبْدِ That it's obligatory upon the person to pray Salatul Duha. Salatul Duha suffices you. All of these sadaqah, you don't do it 360 righteous deeds every day, run around. Just pray these two rak'ah and that suffices you. Some of the scholars, they took from this وَتُجْزِئُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ رَكْعَتَانِ يَرْكَعُهُمَا مِنَ الضُّحَى As the Prophet said, that two rak'ah that you pray suffices you from all of these تَعَدِلُ بَيْنَ الثَّنَيْنِ وَتُعِينُ الرَّجُلُ فِي دَابَتِي فَتَحْمِلُهَا عَلَيْهِ All of that, you don't have to do it. Two rak'ah, you pray. Salatul Duha. It will suffice you. Naam.
الحديث السابع والعشرون عن النواس بن سمعان رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال البر حسن الخلق والإثم ما حاك في نفسك وكرهت أن يطلع عليه الناس رواه مسلم وعن وابصة بن معبد رضي الله عنه قال أتيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال جئت تسأل عن البر قلت نعم قال استفتي قلبك البر مطمئنت إليه النفس واطمأن إليه القلب والإثم ما حاك في النفس وتردد في الصدر وإن أفاتك الناس وأفتوك حديث حسن رويناه في مسندي الإمامين أحمد بن حنبل والدارمي بإسناد حسن
This hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Al-birru husnul khuluq. Bir. What does it mean? Husnul khuluq. To have good manners. If someone asks you, what is the definition of bir? You say, husnul khuluq. Good manners. Al-birr is good, husnul khuluq. Bir is obedience. A person who's obedient is the one who has good manners. Okay. And this, you can always see the hadiths, how they talk about good manners and good akhlaq. Huh? How important it is to have good manners and good akhlaq. وَالْإِثْمُ مَا حَاكَ فِي نَفْسِكَ وَكَرِهْتَ أَنْ يَطَّلِعَ عَلَيْهِ النَّاسِ How do you know something is evil? The way that you know something is evil is that your mind and your heart can't accept it. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala created in us the ability to know when something doesn't feel right. Okay. That's why a lot of people come up to you and say to you, brother, I have a question. Hey, what's the question? My question is this permissible? Why are you asking me if it's permissible? Has anyone ever asked, is it permissible to drink water? Yeah? Do people ask that? But then they come and they ask you, is it permissible to drink this? The reason why they're asking is because the nafs, something saying to him in his heart, whether it's little or a lot, Sah? If someone came up to you and said to you, is it permissible to drink water? Straight away you're going to be like, well, what do you mean, water? What type of water are you talking about? And he says, oh, there's alcohol now called water. You're like, oh, that's why you asked. The evil is ma haka fi nafsik. Your nafs, it keeps regurgitating into your heart. It just keeps bouncing back and forth. You're like, ah, shall I do it? Shall I not? Wa karita yattali alayhi nas. But you don't like the people to see you in it. That's what evil is. The other hadith, hadith Wabisat ibn Ma'badin, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, when he was asked about al-birr, he said, istafti qalbak. Birr is ask your heart. Whoa, talk to your heart. This is what the hadith said. Istafti qalbak, ask your heart. Al-birru matma'annat ilayhi nafs. It's what is tranquil in your heart and feels, you feel tuma'nina. وَالْإِثْمُ مَا حَكَ فِي نَفْسِكَ وَتَرَدَّدَ فِيهِ الصَّدْرُ وَإِنْ أَفْتَاكَ النَّاسُ وَأَفْتَوْكَ. And the evil is that which your heart doesn't accept, even if everyone gives you the verdict for it. This alim said it's permissible. The other one said it's permissible. In your heart, you're like, wallahi, it doesn't feel right. This is the ithm. Here, there's a question. A lot of people say, alhamdulillah, I asked my heart, and it told me that I can do this. And they go and they do things that you know is haram. Sah? Problematic, right? Ha. So how do we respond to this? So clearly the hadith did say istafti qalbak. The word istafti qalbak means ask your heart for fatwa. Istafti. Fatwa comes from there. Ask your heart. Question your heart. So all you just do have to do is anyone time you want to know halal or haram, they say to you, all I need to do is just ask my heart. Why do I even need to go to an alim and ask the mufti? I can just ask my heart. The Prophet told me, go to your heart. We'll say, na'am, but ponder. There are two conditions that the ulama unanimously agreed upon. There are two conditions if you want to take the fatwa of your heart. First one is, كَوْنُهَا مُسَلَّطَةٌ عَلَى مَحَلِّ اشْتِبَهِ. The issue has to be something that there's no clear-cut ruling for. Okay? The issue that you're going to ask your heart has to be of those issues where there are no clear evidences for it. You don't ask your heart whether khamr is halal or haram. There's already evidence for that. No one needs to know what's in your heart. Are we all together? كَوْنُهَا مُسَلَّطَةً عَلَى مَحَلِّ اشْتِبَهِ. The matter has to be something that there is what? Ambiguity regarding it. There is a pull and push. Scholars are differing amongst themselves. There isn't a clear-cut evidence for it. That's the number one. Okay? Number two. أَنْ يَكُونَ الْمُسْتَفْتِي قَلْبُ مُتَّصِفًا بِالْعَدَالَةِ الدِّينِيَةِ وَالْإِسْتِقَامَةِ الشَّرْعِيَةِ. The person has to be a person who's upright on his religion. A steadfast individual. A person who has a taqwa. A person of what? Taqwa. God-fearing, very conscious of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. But if you're a person who is drinking khamar and then you say, ask my heart whether this transaction is halal or haram, then you don't care about the deen. Okay? You have to have adala diniya, adala in your heart. And there's a third condition I think it would be nice to add on to it, is it has to be a person of knowledge. Even that though it falls under the first one, because to know that this issue is, there's no clear-cut ruling for it, you have to be a person of knowledge. Huh? The first condition implies that you know where there are clear-cut evidences and where there are no clear-cut evidences. Are we all together? I can, كُلُّ عَمْرٍ وَبَكْرٍ وَزَيْدٍ وَخَالِدٍ. Everybody can go and just ask his heart, and is it halal or is it haram? This is not right now. Preferred than other manners. Yeah, without a doubt, the best manners is the manners with Allah Azza wa Jalla. The greatest, highest level of good manners is not to associate partners with Allah Azza wa Jalla. At-tawheed is the greatest, the highest level of good manners. Like to say Allah has a child, or to say Allah is one of three, or to say that I'm going to ask someone else other than Allah Azza wa Jalla, and then I'm not going to ask Allah directly. All of these are bad manners and bad akhlaq with Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's the greatest that a person should focus on. If your manners with Allah is bad, then of course your manners with others is going to be what? Terrible. Also, from the greatest characteristics or the greatest forms of manners is as-sidq, truthfulness. To be somebody who's truthful. Sidq is a great, noble characteristics. Nabi Muhammad, that was a characteristic he was well known for. To be a truthful person. Say it even if it's... Huh? Say it if it's even something you believe that it's gonna cause your life. There was one of the great Sahabas, or whether he's a Sahabi or Tabi'i is disputed. He had two sons who were rebels. He had two sons which were rebels. They rebelled against Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. They rebelled against him. And Hajjaj ibn Yusuf killed 120,000 people. He killed companions. He had no mercy in his heart. Sah? Hajjaj ibn Yusuf killed people, spilled blood. That's who he was. Even they said when he died, he was so evil that he said when he died, when you take me out of my house, destroy every building that you go by. When you take, don't divert me from my route and go around and come on the road or anything. They said, he's dead, right? He said, whenever you come to a building, destroy that building. Keep moving like that until you come to the grave. When he died, he wrote that as his wasiyah. Are we all together? Jabbar, arrogant, tyrannical individual. Hajjaj had no qala dharra of mercy for the people. He didn't. He killed Sa'id ibn Jubair, the student of Abdullah ibn Abbas. Killed him. Had nothing in his heart towards anyone. Ala kulli hal, this noble imam, his two sons were rebels. They were going against Hajjaj. And they wanted to take him down. What did Hajjaj do? He was looking for them. They were wanted. He wanted to grab them and kill them. So one day these two children, they sneaked into the city and they came to their dad. And they wanted to spend the night with their father and they ran away. News spread that his two sons were in his house. And he was known to be truthful. They said he never lied. He never lied. His name was called Zir ibn Hubaysh. Zir ibn Hubaysh never lied, they said. Ever in his life. That's what they said. So his two sons came to the house. They said, let's go to Hajjaj ibn Yusuf and tell him that Zir's two sons are in the house. Today we're going to know if Zir ibn Hubaysh is going to tell the truth. Hajjaj ibn Yusuf asked for Zir to be brought to him. He said, come here. Where are your two sons? Have you seen them? Have you come across your two sons? He said, yes, they are at home. I just left them at home. Allahu A'lam, whilst I was on the way, whether they left the house or not, I don't know. But I promise you, when I left them, they were at home sleeping. Hajjaj, no mercy. Gonna kill these children. That's definite for everybody. Hajjaj was shocked. You left them at home? Yes, I left them at home. They are at home sleeping. I left them sleeping. Hajjaj said, because of your truthfulness, I will not touch your sons. I will not touch your children. Your two sons can live. So sometimes you think if you lie, you can get away from this problem. Sah? Yes, sometimes you feel that way. Sah? Just lie and inshallah ta'ala, you get away. Hajjaj never left anyone alone. And look at that, subhanAllah.